sight of the Lord is as yesterday when it's past. And oh, satisfy us early in with thy mercy, that we may rejoice and be glad all of our days. Let thy work appear unto thy servant, and thy glory unto their children. And let the beauty of the Lord our God be upon us, and establish thou the work of our hands upon us. Yea, the work of our hands establish thou in song. Draw nigh to God, and he will draw nigh to you. Cleanse your hands, ye sinners, and purify your hearts, ye double-minded. Humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord, and he shall lift up the Almighty God. Thou dost give life to man and dost receive him again in death. We thank thee for thy abiding presence and for the grace provided in Christ Jesus. In our frailty, we will look to thee for strength, and in our sorrow for comfort. Let us in this hour to put our trust in thee, that we may receive light and understanding and a new experience to thy grace unto eternal hope. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. The Lord is thy shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. And yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. May we please remain standing for the blowing of the shofar. Be seated in the presence of God. On behalf of Emmanuel Worship Center, we would like to welcome you to the homegoing service of our dear brother, Aaron K. Hawkins. And right now we will have a musical selection from Sister Terry Green, followed by the opening prayer of Nasi Joseph W. Green.
Good evening. Oh, we bless the Lord. We give him glory and we give him honor, because he's still God, and he's God alone, And I said to the family, God bless you. I know it's a hard time. And it don't feel good right now, but God is still in control. You gotta trust him, even when you can't even trace him in this situation. But we give God glory, and we give him honor just because he is God, and he is God alone. And how great is our God? So we bless his name, because he's a wonderful God. He's a merciful God. He's our God. He's our master, our savior, our king. God, we bless your name. How great thou art, O God. O Lord, my God, when I awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands has made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe is displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee. How great thou art, yes, you are God. How great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with a shout of acclamation and take me home with joy, will fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration, and then I'll proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee. How great thou art, how great is our God. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Thank you, God. Hallelujah. How great is our God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord God.
Back to the program, Terry.
Nasi, come on.
Let us pray. All merciful, gracious Elohim, our God, it's only you, Lord God, that can bring shalom, bring the peace that would help us to understand times like this. Phone calls may come, cards may be read, rightfully so. But it's only you, Lord God, that can give us the shalom. Because you are Yahweh, the Lord of Shalom. You are Yahweh Shalom, Lord of our peace, who gives peace, who brings peace. So Father God, I pray right now for the Hawkins family, Father. For everyone that's close and dear, Lord God, to this family, Lord God. I pray in the name above every name, Jesus the Christ. I pray and I ask in his name, Lord God, that you send your ministering spirits to brother and sister Hawkins' side, to the family, to the friend, to the loved one, to the brother. I pray in the name of Yahshua that you dispatch your angels, Yahweh, to be there to lift them up, to guide and direct them, Lord God, as they go through this season, Lord God, of mourning. I pray, Lord God, that you just do like you always do. And give them a knowing that they know that they know that they know that all is well. All is well. And gracious God, we just bless you. We thank you for the life of this young man. And we thank you, we bless you, Lord God, for the words that he even shared, Lord God, even through his artwork, the messages that he gave, Lord God, through his art, Lord God, showing, Lord God, the inner thoughts and inner desires of this young man. I pray and I thank you that it will continue on in all those that know him through his artwork, for the art is a message. So we thank you that his message will continue. But Father God, we will always be careful to give you all the praise, the glory, and the honor. It is in Yahshua, Jesus' name we pray. Let us all say amen.
And so we will now have our scripture reading, the Old Testament. Elder Laura Burke, followed by the New Testament reading by Sister Nellie Key, in that order.
Praise the Lord and good afternoon to everyone, especially to the Hawkins family. You have our sympathy, but we know that God is with you. He will strengthen you. We bless the Lord as the psalm that has been chosen is the 8th psalms. This psalm is all about the glory of man and the honor of God. And it reads thusly, O Lord, our God, how excellent is thy name in all of the earth. Who has set thy glory above the heavens? Out of the mouth of babe and suckling hast thou ordained strength because of thine enemies, that thou mightst steer the enemy and the avenger. Who, when I consider the heavens, the work of thy fingers, the moon, the stars, which thou hast ordained. What is man that thou art mindful of him, and the son of man that thou visitest him? For thou hast made him a little lower than the angels, and have crowned him with glory and honor. Thou hast made him have dominion over the works of thy hands. Thou hast put all things under his feet, all the sheep, the ox, yea, the beasts of the fields, the fowls of the air, and the fish of the sea, and whatsoever passes through the path of the sea. O Lord, our Lord, how excellent is thy name in all the earth. God's blessing is upon his word. Amen.
Good afternoon. I will be reading the New Testament scripture, 1 Corinthians 15, beginning at verse 51. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in the moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. For the trump shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruption must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So then, this corruption shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Wherefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. For as much as you know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. Amen.
To the Hawkins family. Sister Connie, when I was talking to you earlier, I understood what you were saying about how tough a position this is for a parent. No parent thinks of their child going before them. So with this, I offer this prayer of comfort for your family. Let us pray. Amen. Father, we don't always understand what it is that you're doing. But Lord, help this family to trust in what you have done. For none of us, Father, know how long we're going to be on this earth. But Father, I ask a special prayer for this family because Aaron was the baby boy, and none of them ever thinks about the last being first. And so, Lord, they're going to need special time to grieve but you're the God of all comfort. And because you're the God of all comfort, I pray for them that you will give them peace that passes all of their understanding and all of their thoughts about how things should be. But that your mind is not our mind. And allow them, Father, to see the glory of the life that was lived, Father, all that has been written down and condensed in the life of a young man that has done so much. I pray that this mother and father and these elder siblings will be able to have pride in what they have done and cherish the moments that they've had with Aaron while he was here on earth. And then, Father, let them trust and rest in the assurity that they will see him again. And as the scripture says, Father, that he will be known as he was known on earth. Still their son, and still their sibling. And this we ask in the precious name of Yeshua HaMashiach, and all that could agree and support this family in prayer said amen. Amen. So now we'll have a musical selection. You'll Never Walk Alone.
When you walk through a storm,
Now we will have acknowledgments and expressions of love, Dr. Maxine Collins.
Shalom. Baruch atah mishpah. Blessed are you, my family. And I would like to say to the Hawkins family, you will never walk alone. As long as you have us as your family, I heard it said today, we are a village, and it takes a village. Keep in mind, keep it in your heart that we are here for you. Amen. I have a few cards here. That I'm going to read. This one says, when the joys are still remembered, but the sorrow has quietly gone. There will always be a special place in the heart where love lives on with deepest sympathy. And this is from Esther Britt. Words are inadequate for expressing how our hearts go out to you and your family during this time of loss. Praying for you that the Lord's comfort will give you strength in the midst of this time, very difficult time, with care and sympathy, the Andrews family. Promises of God's comfort and hope. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. John chapter 11, verse 25 and 26. God's love was revealed among us in many ways. God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. Thanks be to God who gives us victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give you. I do not give it to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Do not let them be afraid. May God's hope-filled promises bring comfort to your soul and peace to your heart with heartfelt sympathy, Aunt Elmira Griffin. Remembering their beautiful song. God gives every person their own unique song. It's one that will play their entire life long. Through the love that they give and the gifts that they share, through the memories they make and the dreams that they dare. It's a song filled with beauty and day-to-day grace that plays through until they see God face to face. A song that is heard in the heart loud and clear. A song, if we listen, we're always still here. What a beautiful way to celebrate them through the song they live, the song you'll carry forever in your heart, in sympathy and prayer. Moses and Angela. In the deepest sympathy. May you find comfort in the memories that are yours to cherish always, and strength in the companionship of those who have shared your loss. Cordelia Perron. In sympathy. Although no words of sympathy can ease the loss you bear, still, may you find some comfort knowing others truly care. And this was from Coach Brian Stith and family. Prayer in times of loss and more than reaching up to God and him reaching down to us. It's him sitting next to us, putting his arms around us, listening to every word and holding us tightly through our tears. praying you feel his loving arms surrounding you today with care and sympathy. Sister Teresa Smith. Letter resolution from Emmanuel Worship Center. How blessed are the dead who die united with the Lord. From now on, that they may rest from their efforts, for the things they have accomplished follow along with them. Revelation chapter 14, verse 13, the Jewish New Testament. To the family of Aaron K. Hawkins, Pastor Barry Green and the Emmanuel Worship Center family express our heartfelt condolences for the loss of your loved one, whom God has called from his labor. Although we are saddened by his death, we resolve to humble ourselves to the will of the King of the universe in his decision. Our comfort lies partly in knowing that your loved one is now resting in peace, yet we are also comforted in knowing that the Almighty King is a faithful rewarder concerning that which he has promised. God promised that he would not leave you comfortless. So be encouraged to call upon the Lord, as he is your refuge and your strong tower. We pray you find peace and strength in his arms. As we include you in our prayers, we trust that your period of bereavement will suffice and the cherished memories will eclipse the pain of his absence. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress. My God, in him I will trust. Psalms 91, verse 2. With deepest sympathy, Pastor Barry Green, Emmanuel Worship Center. To the Hawkins family, we are your village. Amen.
And now I believe we have a video.
All right.
You got it, Rich.
How do you breathe again? How do you make those incremental adjustments to go on when the world never even skipped a beat? How do you accept the unacceptable? Losing someone you love is never easy, especially when it's someone as special as you. We grew up together, not just under one roof, but with one soul. We were kinetic. We spoke without words. Applehead, biscuithead, roughhousing like siblings and arguing like kinfolk and smirking because we got away with it all. I watched you grow up, then grow out. Nothing could contain your energy. You would warm as well as burn. Some would thrive in your light and others needed shade. You inspired my art with yours and you indelibly honored mine with skin. Kiki, I will always love you. No matter what realm, heaven, or spiritual level you're on right now, you will always be in my heart and soul. You were there for me even when I moved to another country. You came all the way across the country to help me pack and saw me to the airport. We laughed. We cried, we shared, we makirarad. We laughed until our bellies hurt. You always had a generous heart. You took the time to love up family and friends. And when you hug people, you hug deeply. When you help people, you helped compassionately. Your art not only breathed life into canvases, but it changed lives. When you gave advice, you seemed guided by a higher power. I know what you knew. When I found out that you left this world, I had to learn how to breathe again. Breathing strong, small sips like grain alcohol, harsh and nasty on my lips for the first time, waiting for the right moment when life blends this grief into a cocktail to make your absence drinkable, palatable. I'm going to miss you terribly, and until I get past the veil to see you again, I love you, Aaron.
there any other members of the family or friends that would like to say something? Anyone? You okay? Come on, brother. Come on.
I stand first in silence just to remember the seed that Aaron planted with me of finding peace. But I also breathe just in gratitude for everything that Aaron planted all across New Mexico, all across the hearts of all the people that he showed something a lot of us never had. A brother. Care for one another, growth beyond the pains and trauma of childhood, movement that expounded beyond just time and the physical plane, but something greater that our Lord has ordained, healing beyond measure and running across the realm to find what God buried in each of us, which is a beautiful treasure. Art in every movement and in every breath. Art amongst beautiful black earth, Kala'i. As I got the call about my bro, I was in meetings, I was dealing with my kids, I was in the midst of the everyday rigmarole, but I knew something wasn't okay. So I dropped everything I was doing and I was saying that I was on the way. Mama Hawkins, Pop. I didn't know what I didn't have in my family until Aaron shined a light on those dark places. But that's why God gives us a village. So we connect the dots between all those spaces. I'm an artist, I'm a dancer, I'm a choreographer, a creative, a warrior. And that's where Aaron and I met, was on the live battlefield of being very lonely warriors in the deserts of New Mexico. But where these beautiful women's hearts that kept us from being jaded also showed us love. Aaron was always there for more people than you could even count on. Your whole entire mind space. The mindscape of Aaron came and shared so much that he said, in Virginia, in home, y'all have to come together. One of the most beautiful things he was sharing in New Mexico was saying that here in Virginia, there are so many faces and so many people that we all needed to meet, and we all kept saying we would get around to it. I almost didn't come because I had so much on my plate. So I just decided to spill my plate and just be here because I knew we may not have another now. Now is all we have. And Aaron always used to say, be present right now. Don't be fair weather. Be right now. Now is when we have to be. And as many nows as we can have, that's when we're really in this thing that is the present. So I thank Aaron for letting me receive the present of all of you. I'm glad that I could be here as a representative of my family who held so much love for Aaron and everyone wished they could be here, but I'm here to represent the Pickets. The Pickets are a family Aaron always would say, you know, y'all are legendary. You go back to Bill Pickett. And I would say, you legendary. You go back to so many things. He wanted to make a black cowboy film. But what I would really love to share is that Aaron said my dance was the one thing he never knew a man could bring. Aaron said that I danced the way he painted. He said my ballet was like a silent wind of a warrior's story. I haven't danced since the last time I danced for Aaron until last night. When I got the call, I did a dance in ritual and ceremony for Aaron because I already knew Aaron was like, you better dance for me. As I danced, the trees shook, and I felt Aaron moving. As I danced, the chaplain began to have tears in her eyes, and she said, you are a very special friend and brother to this man. And she said, you changed every single one of these officers' minds as you've stood here tonight. I hadn't yet met my extended family, but Aaron always told me, I want you to meet the family. I was very sad that we had to meet in this way, but Aaron has gotten every wish that he's had. He had never had all of his art on an entire gallery displayed together, but he has that now. He wanted Kina, Faith, myself to always come out here and meet y'all, see y'all, and again be with the family that he told us about. We weren't able to do that dance together in the physical. But now as he limitlessly dances amongst the clouds and amongst all of our hearts, it seems as though he's bringing us closer together from across the lands. I would like to silently just move. To just share with y'all one thing from my heart and from my dance. But again, I say ashe to this brother because he showed us things that we all need to see. But then I realized, Mama Hawkins, Papa Hawkins, everything that he brought to us was also an extension of the olive branch that is this family tree.
That's powerful. Amen. Memorial montage. After that, we will have a silent reading of this tremendous obituary on this wonderful young man. Mm-hmm. Poppy, you want to say something?
Come on. Shalom, everyone. As I look out and see all the people here who really cared about our son, it makes my heart glad. It does. And I just want to say that even though our son is gone in the natural, he is ever present in the spirit. Not just because of, you know, his physical presence or whatever, I don't know, but I know that what he stood for, what he had done, is ever present. And I thank each and every one of you who had done, had any contact with him for any reason. Some of you remember when he was a little boy coming to the church. And it was really funny because I would bring both of the boys and we would always stand to praise. And ever so often they would want to sit down. They would sit and then I would do this. They would stand because they needed to reverence God. Not me, not whoever, but reverence the presence of God. And I do believe that they've never forgotten that. No matter where they went, where they were, deep down in the soul. You know, those things that you learn as a baby never really leave. They may lie dormant. You may suppress them, but they're always there. So I am happy in a way. I miss my son, but my son is with God. He did what he was born to do, you know, in his way. But I would say this, even if it was in his way, God permitted it. So he allowed him to be who he is. And that's what we always wanted. We knew the spirit of art was always running in our family. We just didn't know where it was going to go. And this he's just a product of it, the bloodline. So we thank each and every one of you. And my husband might have something to say, I don't know. But it's been a long journey. It took a while to get him here. I thank you, though. Thank you for each one who waited patiently for this to happen and all that helped, all that stood by us. And I'm going to give you all thank yous anyway. You know I love you. I'm a huggy. If I can see you, I'm a huggy. My husband.
Thank you all who came today. Give praise to God for what I'm about to say. When we went to New Mexico, we saw such a vast multiplicity of cultures and lifestyles that had come to pay homage to our youngest son. There were folks from all ethnic groups, all walks of life, all political sides. They all came to pay homage. And for a moment, just for a brief moment, I wondered, what would this world be like if we could all have that same spirit? My God, what we could be. And then I'm remembering what an old mentor of mine told me once before. When we pray, don't forget to thank God. And remember this, God, I'm not what I should be. I'm not what I'm going to be, but I thank you, dear Lord, because I'm not what I used to be. Thank you. Amen.
Are there some others? Please.
Okay. I have to read this because I'm not as I don't flow like Trey and others. But I wrote this for you guys and for Aaron. Some people leave this earth, and there's not much to say other than we love them and we'll miss them. But in this moment, there are not enough words that would ever fill the vast empty space Aaron has left. I've known Aaron for almost 17 years. We weren't close until about 10 years ago. But in the years leading up to that, I watched him because we lived in a small community. He was amazing, and I was absolutely blinded by him. He charmed everyone from the oddest of backgrounds. He lit up every space he entered with his smile, his art, his music, his honesty, and his funny giggle. Sometimes he was so honest, he enraged people, but no one could ever stay angry at him for very long. He sometimes had mean, honest words to say, but they were always followed by his immense outpouring of love and acceptance. I remember he rode his motorcycle around town with his wild dreadlocks before the mohawk and sidearm out for the world to see. It was a beautiful sight and empowering just to know he was around. About 10 years ago, Aaron and I became close friends. I'm an ecologist, and I needed a research assistant, someone who could spend months in the mountains with me and help me collect biological data. Aaron volunteered. I had been through many research assistants, and they were all terrible because it's a hard job. You have to be willing to camp for months and then be outside through rain, snow, and hail. Aaron was the best research assistant I ever had. I saw a whole new side of him that I had not expected. He treated every plant with care and laid in the grass and talked to bugs. He loved being in the wilderness and learning survival skills. Then we started mushroom hunting, and of course, Aaron could spot the wild edible mushrooms before anyone else. He brought his magic to everything he did. He was a gift to so many ways. We became inseparable friends. But despite my love for the wilderness and his ability to be there with me, that was not what moved me most about Aaron. He healed my heart and soul in a way nothing else ever could. I come from a family of men who have rarely said a kind word about black women. They all married white women and caused us a lot of hurt, the black women in the family. But Aaron loved us like no man I could ever imagine would. He saw us when no one else did and told us so because he knew we needed to know we were seen and cherished. He painted monuments to us, so much so that almost every black woman in Santa Fe has a portrait of his. He'd made money by painting, speaking, and living his truth, and never ever selling out to appease the majority. He lifted us up and celebrated our imperfections. He healed us with his hands and his heart that overflowed in some endless stream of strength and warmth. He protected me, us, built for me, and showed up when no one else would. Whether we were fighting or crazy, stupid, in love, he told me every day, multiple times a day, how much he loved and valued me. He was my soldier, my brother, and one of my best friends. He gave me walkie-talkies so that he could always find me when I was wandering in the mountains. He gave me guns and knives to make sure not even he could hurt me. But he never hurt me, never tore me down. Instead, he made me unbreakable, invincible, and helped me shine so bright that no one could put out my fire. He held me when I cried, put my heart back together 1,000 times, loved my daughters, and checked in on my mom when even I didn't. I can't even begin to describe the amount of love and support he showed me, my family, my friends, and everyone around him. Yep, he had a sharp tongue, and he could be super hurtful, but his love overshadowed it all. He always showed up when any of his friends needed him. He taught us all about love and family and begged those of us that were close to him to come to Virginia with him to meet all of you so that we could see how much love he had come from. He just wanted us all to be together. I'm sorry, Aaron. I'm sorry I wasn't there for you when you needed me. I'm sorry you couldn't call me. I wish somehow I could go back in time, even if just to hold you in the end or tell you how much I love you. You consumed my entire heart. Never have I loved someone the way I loved you. Death seems so much less scary now because I hope that somehow, some way, I will catch up with you, find you, even if just for a moment. I'm sorry. I love you till the end of time.
Is there anyone else? Come on, bro.
Well, my name is Aaron's brother. That's what I've been known as for a good part of my life and his. And as we put him to rest, I am proud to be Aaron's brother. There are few people that can enjoy what they loved as a child and live that life. You know, Aaron loved art. Aaron loved music. Aaron loved the martial arts. And he grew up to be a man that incorporated all those things in his life. I just can't help but think about that when we went down to New Mexico and the outpouring of love, people that knew him. I mean, and all his artwork. I can't believe he's gone, really. He was such a strong spirit. He was such a man's man. Everybody that knew him admired him because he could be honest with people. And they still love him for it. He was always himself. You don't know anybody like that. It was always themselves in front of everybody, crackhead or clergy. I'm trying to tell you. I didn't think I was gonna cry coming up here. And I'm sorry to break down like this. Whenever a productive man dies, it's always untimely. So I mean, I guess the best thing I could say is, if you know some productive men, you honor them while they are alive. And yes, the men. I'm sorry. He didn't let nothing stop him from his goals. He didn't waste any time. This was a life, although it was shorter than it was supposed to be, it was a life well lived. It's not always the years of the life. What is it? It's the life in the years. And Aaron lived a good life. He made a good impression. And if y'all see me in the street, just call me Aaron's brother, that's all. Right.
Amen. This year I went to an art show, I think, for the first time that I can remember, because you don't want to be on the pulpit lion. And I gave Eliezer a flyer about the art show. And I went in there and I don't recall ever going to an art show before. And seeing all these paintings and all these drawings. And I stepped into a different world. And it just showed me some things and gave me some thoughts that I never had before, looking at art. I had a chance to see some of Aaron's artwork, Hawkins, and just the different things he drew. And knowing that there's messages behind all of that artwork. And then, like his father said, being able to cross cultural boundaries, and I think, as I said, the crackhead to the who you said? That's a powerful person. That's a powerful person. I was so touched by the artwork when I went there. That thing was a Saturday or Friday evening. And I was so impressed by the work. Now, I'm going to reach back when I say this. Don't run out to church. Back in the days, I used to wear an 8-ball coat. Y'all remember the old coat with the 8-ball on? Or y'all too safe for that? Y'all remember that? I wore that to the church at a Hawkins because I wanted to show, that art impressed me, so I wanted to give a message, even with the coat on in front of the people. What am I saying? This young man, the life he lived will live on in his work. The message will not die. And I'm quite sure it will continue to inspire people to even express themselves in art. Be free and comfortable to express yourself. First time I ever seen somebody, I ain't no artwork could be a plain sheet of paper and people pouring liquid on it. Have you ever seen that before? See that brother say, I had never seen that before. But the end result of that was a beautiful thing. It's just so amazing what we just don't tap into. So just looking at the work that this young man has done, and then I saw a piece of work with some Hebrew letters on it. Where y'all think he got that from? So, Etta Hawkins, Sister Hawkins, work well done in raising that young man to touch as many lives as he has touched and that he will continue to touch. Hallelujah.
So we want to take a few minutes and have a silent reading of Aaron's obituary. And after that few minutes, we'll have a musical selection, I Can Only Imagine. And then after that musical selection, the next voice you will hear is our very own Pastor Barry Green, our eulogist for today.
To dream the impossible dream, to fight the unbeatable force. with unbearable sorrow, and to run where the brave dare not go. The unrightable wrong, and to love pure and chaste from afar, to try when your arms are too weary to the unreachable star. This is not where to follow that star. Ooh, no matter how hopeless, no matter how far, to fight for the right without question or pause, to be willing to march into hell for that heavenly cause. And I know if I'll only be true to this glorious quest, that peaceful and calm when I'm laid to my rest, and the world will be better for this. Oh, that one man scorned and covered with scars still strove with his last ounce of courage to reach the unreachable.
Face is before me. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart fear? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine when all I would do is forever worship you. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will
good afternoon, saints. I will be brief. I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. This has been a heavy season for all of us. But I stand before you
and my heart truly aches. I was one of the individuals that remember Aaron and his brother when they were a lot younger, and so was I. Beautiful family. Beautiful family. Connie had the distinct pleasure and the awesome responsibility of having to share a home with three hardheads. But don't you all worry, she could more than hold her own. To hear some of the things that I heard about Aaron, particularly, I got a chuckle out of what his brother Ralph said about preachers. And now I know why Connie asked me to give the eulogy. Because I feel the same way about preachers. Seriously. Folks, what I gleaned from what I read and from what I heard, Aaron was not a phony. Aaron was not a phony. When you have the distinct pleasure of growing up and having your father in the home, and he takes time and he teaches you self-defense, and you get to practice on your brother. And Ralph, being older, I'm sure he could take him. But when I start seeing some of the other pictures, Aaron's as big as Ralph. And I got to thinking about my own situation. When we were coming up, I used to pick at my brother Arthur, and Arthur's a lot bigger than I am now. The memories that you all have, Ralph and Connie, they'll be precious because, not because some preacher says so, but they're precious because when you remember him, remember it was the two of you coming together that created him. And that's special. Ralph, your little brother will always be with you. To have a young lady say the things that she said, every man on the face of the earth would love to have that said about him. But even more powerful, for another man to talk about real friendship, that's something that has been very vital to me. It's imperative, brothers, that we really be brothers to one another. And too much of that is missing, particularly, unfortunately, in the church. most of us know that in life, you're not gonna have but a handful of real friends anyway. And I'm not talking about, and I'm not knocking, fair weather friends are okay. I mean, that's somebody you might work with, somebody you might go to a ball game with, go shopping, all of that's nice. But when you got a 2 or 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning friend, that's a real friend. When someone will inconvenience their schedule for you at the most inopportune time, that's a real friend. This brother touched a lot of people being real, not necessarily caught up in being politically correct, not remembering the things that his parents taught him when he was around certain people. You heard it from his brother. He was himself wherever he went. And the thing that I really liked was the things that his parents taught him and the things that he studied on his own. And even the portions of Torah that he lived, not just learned to recite to try to impress people. The brother lived it. What he understood, he lived. And that's something church folk, we need to start doing. Stop being so impressed because you can recall certain scriptures, but you don't know how to apply them. And the listen, from our vantage point, if you're not doing it, you don't know it. This guy, he had no limitations. And from what I understand in talking with his parents, particularly his father, he would challenge people, but in a good way. But you know how some of us are when we're being challenged, particularly if we like to move at our own pace and we belong to the school of procrastination. Or, you know, well, that's a little unpleasant. I really don't want to deal with it. I'll do it tomorrow. It seems Aaron was the type, do it now. Church folk like to talk about faith a lot. And it's so funny because most of us don't have the right definition of faith. Most of our understanding about faith is as long as God do everything the way I hope, that's faith. No. Faith is sometimes he might say no. Still doesn't change who he is. Aaron believed faith is now. And that same understanding is with him now. He's in eternity. We are too. We just haven't transitioned. But I know you didn't come for all of that today. But I want the family to be encouraged. And brothers, we I didn't even know he could act. You know, I fancy myself to be a so-so actor. When I read that, I was like, man, could I use him? Of course, they would have given him the Oscar, and then I would have been upset. Loss hurts. Family, you take your time and don't feel like you've got to always say or respond the right way. How you feel is how you feel. I'm being real with you. Sometimes well-meaning people, they have a time clock in their minds about when it's time for you to move on. And particularly you, Ralph, take your time. I'm talking little Ralph. That was your brother. With this montage of so many people leaving, I would hope that all of us that are remaining today have taken time. If you got a spouse, that's great. But one day you might not have that spouse. If you still got siblings, that's fantastic. You know, in a matter of time, somebody else got to be first. Brad, why are you talking about things like that? Because this seems to be a season where people are moving on. And those of us that remain, we seem to be caught up in when the next bake sale. That just kind of blows my mind. Now, I know we're not to walk around moping around all the time, but you know, don't let anybody interrupt your grief. That's between you and the one that made you. And if you don't feel like doing something, don't do it. Your brother, your son, he was an amazing person. Listen, there are a lot of us that like to present a certain aura about ourselves, but we're not like that at all. And to see, the thing about a genuine person, a real person, a non-phony, or I like to call them plastic, because we got a lot of plastic people. Plastic people never have anybody get up and say what you heard today. Now, they'll say a lot of nice church stuff about you. Those people spoke from the heart. And it wasn't about how many seminars he attended, how many hours he studied. That young man lived life. He lived it until he transitioned. He followed his passion. I mean, he left his family. His main folks was here in Virginia. He went to New Mexico. How many of us have the, even the courage to move? Not everybody will do that. And I'm not knocking you if you don't. But folks, we need to live for real. And stop living these plastic lives. Take a page out of Aaron's book and just be real. And you know, the first person I would advise you, and it's just advice, you can take it or leave it. Be real with yourself, about yourself. And you'll get a release. God bless you.
Thank you, Pastor. Now we're going to, one moment. Because of the travel for tomorrow for his final resting, we're going to do the committal, and the family has requested the Aaronic blessing, which I will give. So for now, the committal. Ensure in certain hope of the resurrection to eternal life through our Lord Yeshua the Messiah, Jesus the Christ. We commend to the Almighty God Aaron's body to the ground, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, and dust to dust. Let us pray. Eternal God, we bless you and thank you for the life that you have shared, the spark of the divine that you placed in human flesh that walked this earth known as Aaron K. Hawkins. We bless you forevermore and thank you. Amen.
Ivareki Karonai Vaishmareka Yaya Adonai Pandavaleka Vikuneka Isa Adonai Pandavaleka. The assembly call, shalom.
May the Lord bless and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Shalom. Amen.
At this time, the family would have me thank Pastor Green for the words of encouragement, Pastor Hodge, assistant minister, officiant for the day. Each and every one of you.